I'd like to introduce two of our next speakers. The first is Franziska Kruger. Franziska is a German living in Amsterdam, working as a strategist and a freelance consultant who helps organizations see the world through the eyes of their customers on challenges ranging from innovation and business development to branding and communication. And she was one of the first graduates of Knowmads. With her is Pieter Spinder, who is a facilitator and lecturer at the University of Applied Sciences in Amsterdam and is a co-founder of KaosPilots in the Netherlands and is now the initiator and tribe leader of Knowmads. As you can see from your program, Pieter is driven, positive, spontaneous, creative, innovative, and experienced. And he lives in Harlem with artist Rudy, children Jelta and Mira, two cats, and three chickens. So welcome, Fran and Pieter.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Is it understandable also in the back, like with the microphone? Yeah? Okay. First, we want to show you a short movie.
Is to ensure that all Americans have the best education in the world.
Ask me my three main priorities for government, and I tell you, education, education, and education.
Is facing huge challenges, and they're growing daily in severity, in scale, and in complexity. It's no exaggeration to say that they are not going to go away. Indeed, they will get worse unless we can start to find solutions and find them soon. If we are going to survive, we desperately need the next generation to be smarter, more adaptable, and better prepared than any that have gone before. Our only chance is to improve the way we teach our young, to equip young people with the skills and attitudes that might steer this world of ours to a far safer place than at present looks likely. The question is that what our current education system does?
Okay, Fran.
Okay. Can you hear me? Yeah, apparently. Great. So, my name is Fran. I'm one of the first graduates at Knowmads, and you can see also a little bit of other stuff that I've done so far. So, I studied business in Innsbruck, Austria, and also next to my studies founded a student business consultancy named ICANS.
Could you speak louder, please?
Yeah, I'm going to do that. So next to my studies, I founded a student business consultancy named ICANS before I came to Knowmads. I just stopped working at a branding consultancy called Indeed, and I'm a Sandbox member, which is an organization and network for young people under 30 who are innovating and change-making. And I teach design thinking at the Summer University, Carinthia. Peter.
Okay, no, you forget. You forget one most important thing.
I forget one most, oh. Yeah, right. Yeah, that's kind of my life motto, and actually I was not always like that. It's kind of a motto that only came while studying at Knowmads. And I really like it because it kind of takes the pressure from you. So when I was at business school, it was always about, like, what's next? So you go to school, you graduate. So what do you do after graduation? Do you go into a consulting company, or do you become a trainee, or what's next? So it's never focused on, like, what's now? And what do you want to do now? And yeah, so life is an amazing journey to nowhere. Kind of keeps me relaxed and, in the now.
Thank you very much. Okay, my name is Pieter Spinder. I'm 44 years old, and I forgot to put one thing on the invitation. I'm a fanatic Saab 900 classic driver. So apart from the chickens, who were actually eaten by a fox 3 months ago, so they're not alive anymore. And I did a lot of stuff in my life. I'm 44, as I said, I live in Harlem. And in 1998, my wife was pregnant from my first child. And I worked 60 hours a week at a marketing company with 10 other people. And then I thought, this is not really the idea of life. Because before you know it, my son or daughter will come on his scooter to the office and say, "Hi, I'm your son or daughter." So I thought, that's not a good idea. So what I did is I the portfolio of clients I sold to another marketing company and started in the barn in my garden where I started. I went on with the clients I liked the most. And then I was asked by the University of Amsterdam to do a marketing course. And maybe some of you all know the book of Philip Kotler, Marketing Management. I think a lot of you have it unread in the in the library. What happened there is that the idea was that I was going to teach 10 weeks out of the book, and this was still the overhead projector time. And in university they had a book, and in this book was the instructions for the teacher, and it was specifically stated which overhead sheet to put on in which lecture. And for me this was completely strange. So I said, okay, I'm not going to do it. So now, long story short, in the end they didn't want to keep me, so they fired me because the graduation of the students was the lowest percentage ever in the history of university. And then what happened is that 3 months later I was called by the manager, and she asked me, like, what did you do with the students? I said, why? She said, did you pay them or something? I said, no, why? She said, no, because universities in the Netherlands, not only in the Netherlands probably, are ruled by quantitative measurements, like how many people do degree how fast, and what do the students think of the teacher. And the latter thing, so the first one was the lowest ever, and the other one was the highest ever. So she could not really understand, like, what did the guy do? So I said, okay, I want to talk with you about it. So I went to a university, and we had a three-hour talk, and I explained to her that I went to companies where I was working for, with the students, smaller and bigger companies, and we did stuff. So we did marketing. So with real life cases, the students were working on stuff which was really happening. On a certain moment, she picks up the phone and she says to somebody on the other line of the phone, I think we got him. Sounded a little bit Mossad CIA thing or something, so I didn't really understand. So and then she offered me a job. She said, okay, you can ask whatever money you want and how long you want to work here, and we want you to do new stuff in university. So that's how it started. I did. And during the quest, I was busy with, like, seeing, okay, what can we implement in university education? I came across KaosPilots. And you heard the whole story of Simon. And What happened is that there were two guys in the Netherlands busy with starting a KaosPilots branch. First one out of Scandinavia. So we did, or they did actually, and 2 months later I joined. And this was a sort of homecoming for me. This was really, really great. I was also always introduced to new clients by Peter and Martin, the two founders of KaosPilots Netherlands. This is Peter. He walked in and he never went away. So they did not really have the idea what I was doing there. I stayed there for 2 years. I went in the end of the second year, like what Simon was telling, we went on an outpost to Israel-Palestine. Students choose themselves where they wanted to go. So we had the option to go to, Afghanistan, Johannesburg, Rio de Janeiro, or Israel-Palestine. They had a 3-day conversation about it, like what they want to learn, what they want to bring into the world. And after 3 days, they called me and said, yeah, we're going to Israel-Palestine. It was in 2009, when just after the Gaza war. We went there, we did 3 months, great projects. We lived in the West Bank near Jenin. We lived in the desert. We changed some stuff in Tel Aviv, in the mall there. We brought a sustainable shop alive, which is still open. And then we came back, and then KaosPilots Netherlands stopped. I was very sad about it, because on the high point of what we were doing, we couldn't go on. So I was sitting home, and very sad. And then my son, who was then 10 years old, I think, 11 years old, he said to me, because what I was doing, I was watching Tour de France the whole day, in my pajama, watching Tour de France and the repetition of Tour de France. So after 1 week, he said, what are you going to do? Are you going to do this for 3 weeks? I said, no, you have a different idea. So let's go on a holiday. I thought, good idea. So we went on a holiday, we came back, and then I came up with the idea Knowmads. It didn't yet exist, the name Knowmads, but what I did is I gathered ex-students from Team 1, who were with me in Israel-Palestine also, where I was working with for 2 years already. I gathered them around me together with other education professionals, and we thought of, okay, how can we bring into the world what we want to bring into the world connected to education? And this took 3 or 4 weeks or something, and then money was needed, so I took an extra mortgage. Some students joined, ex-students joined, and 15th of February 2010, we started with Knowmads. We built a website and we did the whole social media marketing for the school. And, oh yeah, this is a nice thing to tell, like, because the name Knowmads already existed. Does anybody know who invented the name Knowmads? There's one guy in the room who knows. Because actually, he's in the room here. It's not me. It was also not a computer. That's not completely true. You have this program where you can put all kind of words. Wordle, it's called, and then it makes connections of different words to see like how the school would be named. So we were drinking a lot of beer, smoking a lot of cigarettes, and we were the five of us, and we needed to choose, okay, what will be the name of this new school? And then all of a sudden, in the Wordle thing came up, Knowmads. And then we looked it up on the internet, and immediately there was a connection with a guy who's sitting here in the room, and we'll introduce him, John Moravec. Because in 2003, he already came up with the idea of Knowmads and what a Knowmad could be. And it perfectly fitted with what we wanted to do. So I sent him an email, and I said, is it okay that we use the name Knowmads as a school? And he said, yeah, great, what percentage I get? I said, no, it's not really. If you want to get rich in education, don't start a school. So he thought it was great. And there was also another thing, like there's a band from New York, also called Knowmads. Also wrote them a mail if they wanted to do the opening concert of the school and never got a reaction. So that's shortly how Knowmads exists. And I will tell shortly, later on, I will tell something more about it, about the idea. The Next Generation is a new program which I do in university together with 4 colleagues. And it's about sustainable leadership and entrepreneurship. I do this 1 day a week. And also to make the connection with regular education. Because Knowmads is a school completely out of the system. And we're very happy with that. Okay. These are my kids, where I told you about. And I have to, because it's being recorded, so I also have the proof for my little girl. She asked me, where are you going? I said, I'm going to a school in America. She said, aha. I said, okay. So after half an hour, she came back and she made two drawings for the kids where I'm going to talk to. So I have to show it. So this is one drawing. And she said, I asked her, what is it? And she said, it's art. Okay. And the other one she made for you kids is an elephant. And everybody can see that this is an elephant, of course. So I had to show this, otherwise I'm not allowed to come back. My other son, Jelte, he's now 14 years old. He is very much into soccer also. And he was not that interested that I was going here. The only thing he said, you have to bring me a super dry sweater. So when you're 14 years old, you're probably busy with other stuff than when you're 4 years old. My life motto is this, and it's always true. You can also look at it as a sad thing, but I don't think it's sad. But this is most of the time my starting point, together with another thing which I always have in the back of my mind, like take it from here with the given facts. And the thing is that we're living in times now that the given facts are changing so fast, so you have to adapt to it. Like, for example, to call it a financial crisis or a social crisis or whatever. According to me, it's a social transformation or a financial transformation. Like, we need to transform, and we can get the tools of design thinking being used for that. So why is it important for us to start a school like Knowmads? Some people really look at the future and think that it's really scary. And some things are also really scary. That's also why I showed the movie in the beginning. Because this movie, this is the introduction of We Are the People We've Been Waiting For. There's a movie which was made in 2010 when we started Knowmads by Ken Robinson. And it was one of the two movies who had a huge impact in education land. The other one was Waiting for Superman. It's an American movie. Probably some of you know it. And actually, we thought of, we're not waiting for Superman, we are empowering superheroes. That's what we do. So how do you do that if you are only busy with fear? So we said, no, it's not only fear, it's also very exciting, the future appearing. You can look at it from both ways. And then the question is, of course, do you have the tools to cope with the future? And according to us, the starting point is self-awareness. Because if you want to change something, first you have to be very aware of yourself. And if you are aware of yourself, then you can be aware of the other. And if you are together aware of each other, then you can change something which is happening. So self-awareness is one of the key things at Knowmads. And to create something new. And with this slide, I thought of yesterday night, I think, what am I going to tell with this slide? And I thought, Well, 2 weeks ago, I had a conversation with Edwin de Bray, who also John Moravec knows him very well. And he said, actually, there's only one subject which is taught in primary, secondary, and also in university. And this subject is history. So the history of English, the history of economics, the history of geography, the history of philosophy. It's all about history. Well, actually, we want to go forward, and we want to create something new based on experience which we had in the past. So it's not like, okay, forget everything with what happened, but in a more triangle way, which I will explain a little bit later. So we wanted to start a school to shape the future. And by doing this, you have to step into the unknown. If somebody would have told me 5 years ago that I would start a school together with students, actually, because without students, no school, I would have said, yeah, right. I was busy with marketing, with internet companies, this kind of stuff. So you really have to step into the unknown. And for our students, this is also a very important thing. The first students who came, together with Fran, we have 11 other pioneers, which are really heroes of mine, because you have to imagine, you start a school. You start 15th of February. You only have a website. You don't have students. And up until 2 weeks before you start, we didn't know in which building we would be. Then you do all kind of marketing. We got 16 or 17 people interested to join Knowmads. We did a workshop, 2 days workshop. And then you're going back home and you have to tell your parents this story. Okay, mom and dad, I'm going to a school in the Netherlands in Amsterdam, which is, what is it again, John? A cesspool of crime and corruption, according to, whatever. So that's one. Second is you have to tell that you have to pay 4,500 euros for a program which never ran before. You don't get a degree because it's a school with outside of the system. And instead of a degree, you get a tattoo. So then you live in Korea, South Korea, with students from South Korea, from Brazil, from America, actually here from Minneapolis, from Germany, from Austria, everywhere. And you have to tell this. So you really have to step into the unknown if you are going to do this. So these are really the people, the pioneers, who said, okay, let's make something together, let's pull something off, which we really want to do, and we want to do it on a different way. So very risky what we did. And also you have to trust a lot. Like, it seems to be that pictures of the staff on the website look very trustworthy, but still, with the story before, you really have to be sure, like, okay, can I trust these people that we want to bring this into the world? So we were looking for value-driven talent to get a shared purpose and a shared meaning in what do I want to bring into this world. And for us, it was also very important diversity. Diversity is one of the things which is most important in biology, for example, because if you have a big diversity, then you can do stuff. This is also for today, because in the afternoon we're going to do a workshop together with John Foley from Forefront, and we have a very diverse group here. And if you have a very diverse group, then you can really, really foster everything which you want to get out of it, and you can really grow something different than when you have only Dutch students, or only Danish, or only Germans, or Americans. So diversity is a very, very important thing. So this was the main question which we ended up with. Okay, how are we going to take people on a journey, and how are we going to inspire them? So what we do at Knowmads is... Did I skip one slide? Yeah. So at Knowmads, very short slide. We do. Yeah, I have 370 slides. You didn't know it up front, but no. So we ask ourselves three main questions, actually four main questions in general, because we have also connected to the program, we have some questions which we ask ourselves. So one of the first things which I already mentioned before is how do, or what's the level of awareness? And how can you raise awareness of where you are, what you are doing, what's happening in the world, and what you want to contribute there? So it's very important starting point. Also, very important is how do you show leadership? How do you step up front and really do it? And how do you facilitate a learning process where people feel free and secure enough to step up and do stuff? Connecting very much to the story of Simon, like, there's not one idea too big, like we can do. And this you base on trust, and this you base on awareness. And very much, I stole it from Steve Jobs, actually. A lot of people are not playing the lead role in the movie of their own life. They're playing a side role in the movie of somebody else. Oi, oi, oi. This is something. Like, so you have to imagine you're lying in your bed, 78 years old, this was it. And then you have to come to the conclusion that you play a side role in the movie of your boss, or of your wife, or of your whatever. So very important, like, okay, do you want to play the lead role in the movie of your own life? And I am going to connect it to, something which happened before. And actually, I have it similar with the founder of KaosPilots, Uwe Albeck. Sometimes I met him in 2007, and he was in our school 1 year ago. We met in Korea, because we were a lot of times invited together to do news, to tell about new ways of education. And actually, he also has the story. He has the story with surfing, but I have the story with windsurfing. I'm a little bit disabled. I'm born with that. It doesn't hurt. So walking for me is not the most easy thing to do. When I was 14, windsurfing was the thing. but then windsurfing with this big sail on a board. And I went for 3 months, I went to a lake in the neighborhood where I lived, and I tried it. Now you can imagine that if you already stand a little bit wobbly on normal soil, if you are going to stand on a board in the water with wind and a sail, that's a challenge. So I didn't manage. And it's not a bad thing, because I also wanted to become Johan Cruyff. Did also not happen. So, what came out of there is that it's very important how and when are you stepping in. And this is also a choice of students in our school to step in or not and on their own time. So not like, okay, you have to do this or you have to do that. It has to be your starting point when you want to bring something into the world, and then things are also going to fly. So we do a lot of stuff with the creative process. The highs and the lows of the creative process, we are going through it. And I will explain a little bit later about how we're going to do it. It's also about how do you get lost. It's the same thing like how can you learn from your failures. And also, if you work in a team, now we started with 12 students, now we have 35 in 3 different groups, because we also believe in very small groups, because education, according to us, is about rhythm and attention. And if you have a big group, then there's a different rhythm and there's different attention. So we have 3 small groups, and we let them get lost. And we also let them make failures. For example, we promise the students, that's another promise which I can tell their parents in South Korea when they go, we are bringing in 4 assignments per year where the students can work on. In the first week, they start their own company together. They get the key of the school, and we say, okay, this is the program, which is a blank sheet of paper, but we are telling you we're going to bring in 4 assignments. The first year, we brought in an assignment from KLM, where Franziska also will talk about, and also from Royal Haskoning, which is an engineering company, and they wanted to do something with sustainability, but they had a budget. So they had a budget of 12,000 euros, and they worked together with the students on the budget what to do for that money to bring sustainability into corporate companies. So they made a quote, like after working together with the client, they made a quote, and they came up with a great plan. And they showed it to me, said, Pieter, can you read it? Because we want to know what your idea is about. I said, yeah, of course. So I read it. And then the last page was how much it will cost the client, and there was stated 17,000 euros. And I knew that they only had 12,500 euros. So then you have a choice. It's like you say, okay, go back to the drawing board and make it again, or you don't say anything. So I chose for the last thing, which is very hard sometimes. You really have to bite off your tongue sometimes not to say something. They send it to the client, and they didn't hear anything for 3 weeks. So 3 weeks I was biting on my tongue, not to say anything. And then on a certain moment, Oscar, one of the Tribe One members, I passed him in the hallway. And then I asked him, did you hear anything from the quote which we sent to, or which you sent to Royal Haskoning? He said, no. I said, oh, strange. And then I walked on. It was on Friday. Then Monday we have Green Zone, we call it, in the morning. It's kind of a project lab where we go over all the projects where the students are busy with to see where they need help or how is it going. And then one of the students said, maybe we call them and see if they got it or not. So still didn't say anything. So they called them in the afternoon, and they heard from the woman who was in charge there, said, great, really great proposal. We want to do everything you say. But the problem is, now comes the corporate state of mind, we only have 12,000 euros, so 12,500 euros. So we don't understand why you came up with 70,000 euros. So that's why we didn't react. This is a learning which they will never forget. And this is also in the air as a kind of invisible learning for Tribe 5, who started just 2 months ago. Because they know the story, so they know like, okay, hey, this is a different way. But for me, it was 3 weeks getting lost. Because yeah, on a business side, it's not really that smart to do it like this. Apart from that, we work in a team setting, and in the team, there's always a lot of tension and a lot of frustration. It's not that there's blood on the wall, but you have to imagine they work for a Royal Haskoning or for T-Mobile or for KLM or for whatever project, and in the end, there's money coming in, and then they have to divide the money. And then you have the story like, okay, there was one guy, Cornelius, great guy from Germany, but he didn't do anything on an assignment. But he said, I also want money. So this is a gathering together of 12 students and one facilitator, dividing 12,000 or 15,000 euros. And then everybody's looking at him like, well, why do you need money? You didn't do anything. He said, no, 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 it's not true. He said, I made every time I made coffee when they were here, and I bought cookies, and because of that, they were very satisfied, and that's why I want money. So sometimes it can take 2-3 days or 2-3 weeks before they come to a common sense, like, okay, this is how we're going to divide the money. It's not based on hours, because we don't have this clock thing in the beginning of the school, like, boing, how many hours you work. So they really invented themselves. And this brings a lot of frustration sometimes, which is also great. How do you help other people to go through the roller coaster ride? Because it's really a roller coaster ride. You have to imagine that every day our students come up with 3, 4, 5, 6, 20 ideas. And if you're not there, like now I'm here for 2 weeks and I'm coming back, then so much happened that I really need 2-3 days to talk with everybody to see what's happening there. Because it's really going fast. Because they are taking up all kinds of challenges which meet them today and tomorrow. And when you're not there, it's really going fast. So for us, it's also very important to work with a certain structure, and we do a lot with design. And we design our project. We design our projects at Knowmads connected to 5 steps. We always do stuff in action. So actually what I'm doing here, after 20 minutes at Knowmads, so suppose that I would give a talk at Knowmads, after 20 minutes they say, okay, Pieter, enough, we want to work. This afternoon you will work, really, and will really, really also be very sweaty, so we'll really bring up something new this afternoon. But we design things through action, so we put stuff in action. We design with clients, not for clients. Very important difference. If you work for a client, then there's less commitment. If you work with a client, then you can co-create together, like what's needed. You can learn from the profession of the client, and also the client learns a lot from, now we have 35 students from 14 different countries. If you talk with 35 different students about sustainability from 14 different countries, then you hear complete different stories. So it really, really helps also the client to co-create together, like, hey, what can we learn from each other and how can we bring stuff into life? It's also that we design systems and not stuff, because we believe that there's enough stuff. Really, there's enough stuff. What's also very important is that you document, share, and measure what you did during the design process, like, so that you can also learn from it and that you maybe also can apply it in different situations. Social media is one of the biggest examples of that. Huh? Like, in the beginning, I didn't believe in Twitter. Kariana, one of the students who started with us at the school, she said, we need a Twitter account. I said, ah, come on, Twitter, bullshit. And she said, no, 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 we really need it. So, okay, we got a Twitter account and we started tweeting and we had a kind of structure in this. What happened is that in the first year, we have 150 to 200 new people on the website every day, which is not a lot, but we more believe in whispering to the right people than shouting to everybody. So what we do with Twitter is we whisper to the right people, and what happened is that 17% of the visitors on the website of Knowmads came through Twitter, number one. I didn't believe in it up front. So the thing is that it changes so fast, and this is also very much based on creating, discussing, asking questions, and then bring it out there. I hope there's not a Twitter wall now here which says, okay, when is the guy finishing? Because this also happened to me. I gave a workshop, and then all kind of tweets, everybody's laughing. I think what I'm telling is not really to laugh, and then I look at it and I say, oh, okay, okay, we have to finish. So we start locally and we share globally. And I think the terminology globally is really great. So we try to make it as small as possible and as micro as level as possible, but also that it's very easy to bring it into the world and to make it a global thing. And in the end, we also try to build stuff. So physically being busy with the thing which you came up with. And we do it according to a new smart. And everybody here in the room probably knows the old smart, like the goal setting project management tool, which all managers use most of the time, which is specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time bound. And Floris, one of the staff members of Knowmads, 2 weeks ago came up with a new smart where we work with. And it looks like this. So follow the words. It's about the story which you want to tell. And we're also going to work with this in this afternoon with the new smart, see if it really works. So you have a story and you want to bring the story out. What's the story which you want to tell? It also has to be meaningful, what you want to tell. So it really has to have meaning, what you want to bring into the world. It has to be adventurous or activating. It has to be connected to resources or rethinking, like how can we use the same stuff for different purposes. And it has to be televisable, which means that it has, like, it, I don't mean you have to broadcast it on television, but televisable, according to me, or according to Floris, is you have to bring it out there in the world, and it has to be broadcasted by all the different channels which is possible. So we have to bring it out. So actually what we do is taking care. Anybody knows why wolves do this?
Play?
Play? No. Huh? No. They keep each other warm. Like the nose is the most important thing in the body of a wolf, and they take care of each other by doing this. And I think it's a great picture. And also, it's one of my favorite animals because a wolf can live very solemnly alone, but also it can live very good in a small herd of 10, 15 wolves. So we thought it is about taking care. And we didn't want to come up with a theory, because on a theory you can found a school, but a theory doesn't last. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to have a group of values which we made together with the students to found a new culture and to found something else. So, very short, what is Knowmads? It's a one-year program, it's based in Amsterdam. We have international students from all over the world. Based on diversity, we want to work. We do action learning. So our students are working on real-life projects also. And the thing is that they also earn the money which they are earning. So the quote they send out to the client, they earn the money. So it's really about earning while learning. The idea was that they would earn the 4,500 euros which they have to pay for a one-year tuition back. The first group didn't really manage, but Fran will talk about it. The second group had a little bit more luck, but it also depends on how many projects you work. Because the first year we brought in 4 projects from 4 different clients, but the students worked on 54 projects themselves, totally. So they're very entrepreneurial on bringing in new stuff. So it's about bringing the dream, your dream into the world with entrepreneurship or entrepreneurial behavior. Which must sound here in America very good, because this is what, like I heard that 25% of the Americans have their own company or work for themselves. While in Holland, for example, it's only 11%. So we say, okay, bring more entrepreneurship because entrepreneurs are changing the world. And also very much about what is your true potential. Now then our clients, you have to imagine we were sitting with KLM and these kind of partners, T-Mobile, and say, okay, what's your curriculum that we don't have? Oh, okay, but what are the subjects that we don't have? Oh. And you want to work for us? Yeah. And you want to have money for that? Yeah, also. Okay, so we had to come up with a kind of structure which also corporate companies can understand, like, okay, what are the guys doing there? So we came up with 4 questions which we are applying to the assignments which are being brought in, which are these 4 questions. And connected to that, because still KLM and T-Mobile don't understand, like, okay, how do I create the organization to get it done? What is that? What is that? What are you teaching then? So first, we are not teaching. But so what we did is we put subjects to it. So all the assignments which are coming in are about sustainability or social innovation. Doesn't have to be necessary to all the 4 questions, but 1 question. So we did, for example, a marketing assignment. For the last question, we did a sustainable assignment. So we're working with these kind of questions, and we do this together with the students. So we sit and we say, okay, what knowledge is needed? KLM came with an assignment. And then we ask ourselves, okay, what knowledge is needed for this assignment? And we immediately also apply the knowledge to the assignment. So the students are coming up. It's very nice. We had Seth Godin was at, in our school, and also Itai Talgam, so famous TED speakers, also want to give lectures at our place. Probably because we call them the what the fuck lectures. Which means that it doesn't have to be connected to any subject. So not to one of these subjects here. But Seth Godin, he was also there, and Itai Talgam. And then one of the tribe members, they also attend the meetings, which we have as a staff, to see what we are doing. And to bring input and also to bring it back to the students. And one of the students said, can we have more TED speakers? I said, what the heck? Why do we need more TED speakers? Yeah, because they thought it was very interesting to have TED speakers. I said, okay, maybe I try to go on TED and then you have somebody around for the whole year. But it didn't take me up until now. So these are the things where we're busy with. These are the assignments which are being brought in. These are the themes. And we do this with a lot of partners, which some of them might say something to you, like T-Mobile and KLM. Achmea is a very big insurance company in Europe. C-1000 is the second biggest supermarket chain in the Netherlands. And they come with different assignments. And Fran will talk about it. So actually, Knowmads is a platform. This is actually with Uncle Seth. On the gliding, how do you call it, in the slide. And actually it was really great because we came up with, because this is in our garden, and we came up with the terminology, Knowmads is a business kindergarten. And everybody immediately understands this. So now I want to give the word to Fran, and because I can tell you every nice story and with great slides, but she's the experience expert. She did it for 1 year together with us, so maybe she will say nothing is true what the guy says, or maybe not, but she had her own experience, and we think that it's very important that she tells her own experience. Here you are.
Thank you. Okay. I actually really want to tell my own story, because I think every story that every Knowmads student would tell you is a little bit different. So the reason why I told you before that I studied business in Innsbruck is because this is where the story begins. And I always say I studied in Innsbruck and I got an education at Knowmads. Two very different things. So while I was studying, I already was like kind of, yeah, I don't only want to learn from books. So I started a student consulting company with some friends of mine and already worked for real-life clients. And when I was about to graduate, I was, okay, that was interesting. But along the way, while working with these clients and while being in contact with a lot of consulting companies, I also realized that this is not, although it's what I want to do, like what I want to do, this is not the way how I want to do it. So I came back to my parents, and I had a talk with my dad. My dad was kind of happy that I was about to graduate and get a job. I said, okay, Dad, I think I can't work. I can't choose where I want to work. And he said, like, yeah, what's the problem? You have good marks. You have an internship. You already worked in consulting. So it's actually pretty clear that you do a traineeship or that you go into consulting. I said, yeah, but Dad, it doesn't really feel right. And he was like, okay. And one day, I told him, hey, I heard about this great school. And he was like, school? What school? And I was like, yeah, it's called Knowmads. And I have the feeling, like, after seeing the little introductory movie that they did, like, somebody invented a school for me. And he was like, yeah, but you just went to school. Like, don't you want to work? I said, yeah, but this school is different. And I told him the whole story about how the tuition fee is 4,500 euro and that I could earn it back and that I had the feeling like that this school would open up a lot of things to me. And luckily, my dad is a very nice person and he said, okay, you can have the money, But it's a loan, and you told me it's not a problem because you will pay it back anyways. But it's okay for me, and I kind of give you this year. Okay. So Knowmads, and Pieter mentioned it, is a lot of work with and not for. And this is, I think, also what struck me when I heard about the school and how they planned on working with clients. And I think this is also because now I work as a business designer, what strikes me about design. Because design, when it's done well, is user-centric. But sometimes I have the feeling like that exactly this is what people forget. So when you, I think it's kind of funny and also kind of interesting to see the popularity that design thinking during the last years had in business. Because I have the feeling that a lot of companies actually don't really understand what it is. It's like, yeah, there's this process, and when we go from A to C, then we will have better innovation. But actually, the real core, designing for people and being human-centered, I think this is something that is sometimes forgotten. Okay, back to my story. So I came to Knowmads, and I think at this point it was not really clear like what didn't feel right while I was working next to university already. But this is another thing about Knowmads, and I think this is also another thing about design or design thinking, what I also really like. It's rapid prototyping. So you don't strategize and sit in your little box or in your little, whatever, and think about, okay, what if A, or what if B, or what if C, you go out and do it. And I think this is also what we did at Knowmads. No. Dialogue and co-creation. Dialogue and co-creation, this is what I would say, like when I look back to the past things that I did with Knowmads and after Knowmads and during Knowmads, but not with Knowmads, what kind of unites all the projects that we did. And I want to start with the first project that we did with Knowmads for KLM. The task was improving the flying experience for business flyers. KLM came to us and said, yeah, we have this project running within the company. It's called Extended Office. And we want you to bring it alive in our company. And our hypothesis is we have a lot of business flyers out there. And the big problem is actually that they lose a lot of time during going to the airport, checking in, working or not working, not being able to work in the plane, and then until they are at their meeting. So let's say that's on a short-haul flight, about 5 hours. 5 minutes. So we want you to come up with a solution how they can work more efficiently while being on their journey. We thought it's very, very interesting. And although it was very tempting to go immediately into ideation and think, okay, yeah, you know, what could we do about it? Could we maybe, make the space a little bigger so that people can work more comfortable with their laptops? Or one of the first solutions, of course, that came up, it's now, I think, 2 years ago, to bring wireless internet into planes. But luckily, we were also having a little guidance during this process, and we went into a service design process that started with the client, with the customer. So we talked to a lot of business flyers. We flew ourselves, we observed people, and slowly but surely we found out that actually working on a plane is for most of the people not so much of an issue, because especially on short-haul flights, people actually enjoy that they are offline. Very, very big insight. So some of the, I don't go deeper in this project, but, because what I want to tell you with this is that we spoke to the client and we also made KLM seeing the client and not strategize and think about like, yeah, it could be. So going away to their, from their assumption, but really, really talk to people. But some of the stuff that came out of this project, and I heard that it was also written in the New York Times yesterday or 2 days ago, is the social seating of KLM. So you can, before you fly, you can basically see who is on the flight with you, and you can say, okay, yeah, there is John flying with me, and John is interested in how to innovate in cities and how to bring people together and how to foster innovation in cities, and that's a topic that I'm also interested in, so I want to sit next to John. And this is really also the idea that was behind that social seeding. Like, it's not a fancy thing, and so it was really based on, like, how can we use that offline time that people spend next to each other in planes. The next project is a project that I did for a retail company, and it was only like kind of with Knowmads because I started while being a student working with one of our partners. And same thing. We had this retail company and they came up with a great vision actually themselves and it was called Favorite Meeting Places, which is kind of nice. So what the company does is it's a real estate investment company, so they buy shopping centers and try to get a profit out of that. What is unique about them is that they also develop the kind of visions and the concepts for these shopping centers. And this is what we were also busy with. And again, the first thing that we did was talking to people. And when we had the management of Europe in the end there for a big workshop, the first thing that we did is, and that you can see on this picture, we were sending them out into their own shopping center or into one of their own shopping centers and speaking to customers. Big insights. The next and the last project, and it's actually kind of my favorite project, and it will connect to the little assignment that Simon did with us earlier. As I just come back from Oslo, and I was working there with another Knowmad who is now based in Oslo and also my best friend. It's the guy who comes from Minneapolis, so it all comes together here somehow. And I don't know who of you guys is familiar with the Hub network, the co-working space. Okay, a few. So for the others, I explain it shortly. Because the Hub is not only a co-working space, we have like all these co-working spaces popping up at the moment where like freelancers and young entrepreneurs and people work together. But what happens most of the time is that although they work in the same room, they don't work together. So you can sit next to somebody in Starbucks and you have your headphones on and you still don't work together. So the Hub tries to change that and not only be a co-working space, but also really facilitate that people come together, that people are connected, that people learn. And I think this is also what makes the Hub so special for me, or what makes this project so special to me, is because also what we learned at Knowmads is that education and learning doesn't stop when you're out of school. So yeah, we were in Oslo, and this is actually an empty shop. So we utilized an empty shop in Austin if we could use it, and then brought all the stuff that you can see there in for a week and gave people space and connected people and started to doing workshops there and spoke about the future of education and initiated projects. It was very, very nice. And why I think this is, and this is where I make kind of the loop back to what Simon said before, is because when I essentially think about my education at Knowmads and what it gave to me, is that for the first time somebody asked me this question, like, what is your big, hairy, big, bold, what is your big idea? And supported me in getting there and gave me the space to also found it out, because although I think I could already kind of figure out that something was not really, really right when I started Knowmads, I also didn't know at this point how to change it or how to make it better. And I think you could all see like what happened when Simon asked that question. Like, there was so much energy in this room, like everybody started talking. And when we will talk about innovation this afternoon with John, I really also hope that this is something that sticks with you, that this is the basic of, or the basis of innovation, that people ask that question and that you have the space. So I hope that when you are here and you are having a company, that you're asking your employees and the people that you're working with this question, like, what is your idea? And you will see the energy that you are going to release with that. And if you're a graduate or about to graduate and looking for your first job, I really, really hope that you find a job and that you find something where you can bring your idea into the world. Thank you.
So the rest of the 200 slides are now. Are you still ready for it? Or no, two more to go. This is actually one of the things which are very much connected to the big hairy idea. And when I was talking to John and Fran, because we also did the assignment, what's happening now is that what we did 2 years ago in Israel-Palestine, we brought 15 Palestinians, 15 Israelis, and 15 Americans, and 15 chaos pilots together, and we worked for 3 days in a hotel on the border of the West Bank and Israel. And as you know, it's a kind of fiery situation there. So also the CIA and the Mossad and these kind of guys were not really happy with us, but we brought them together, and in 3 days there were really beautiful, beautiful projects starting. So my big hairy idea is to have once a school in Israel-Palestine on the border with 15 Israelis, 15 Palestinians, and then to make a difference, because it really works. A friend of mine, Tomer Hyman, he made a movie which is called The Bridge Over the River Wadi, and he won, I get goosebumps when I tell it, he made a movie which was about Israeli and a Palestinian school, a joint school. So they had 10 kids, Israeli kids, 10 Palestinian kids. And what they did is they made the program together, the kids. So they celebrated also all the holidays. So they celebrated all the Arabic holidays and also all the Israeli holidays together. And the parents were also always there. And what happened is that after 1 year, the school closed. Not because of the kids, because they were very, very sad about it, because they got friendships, they got all kind of stuff, but because of the parents. Because the parents were standing around in a circle during a holiday, which is called Independence Day for the Israelis, because in 1948 they got the country. And the same day is called for the Arabic people Nakba. And what they did is the children celebrated both parties and they didn't have any problem with it. But the parents couldn't stand that to see this. So they had something like, so they closed the school. While actually the thing is that if you would open 50 schools like this in Israel, in 20 years, the problems will be solved because the kids, they are working together. So one of my big hairy ideas is that this will ever happen. This is what I want to leave you with. This is also what we're going to do this afternoon. And John will give the introduction for that. Is that you can be very productive, and then you can do all kind of things, replying emails, paying bills, fulfill all the obligations, make it a task and put it off. Or what you can do is you can organize a community of people, you can take risks, set ambitious goals, big hairy goals, give more than you take, change perception, forge a new path, create possibilities and demand excellence. So don't worry too much about getting things done. But let's this afternoon try to make things happen. Thank you very much.